views. After a national outcry, Starbucks has announced that all 8,000 of its American stores will be closed on May 29 so that its 175,000 employees can receive anti-bias training. Now, here's my question. Does this incident represent a uniquely American problem? Think about it. Starbucks is closing 8,000 American locations for training, but not the totality of its more than 12,000 worldwide. They clearly didn't think that the issue was limited to one Starbucks at 18th and Spruce Streets. They didn't stop with all of Philadelphia or all of Pennsylvania. No, Starbucks expanded to the entire United States. Is that because the problem only exists here? Or is it a PR move? Because this is where the media outrage has been most heated. So either this is a uniquely American issue, or Starbucks is employing a PR stunt because it plays well at home. It has to be one or the other. Joining me now is Washington Post Global Opinions editor Karen Atiya, who had another take on the story under the headline, "Calling the Police on Black People Isn't a Starbucks Problem, It's an American Problem." Hey, Karen, we came at this from slightly different angles, but humor me for a moment on my issue. What do you think about Starbucks closing only the U.S. locations?
Yeah, that's a really interesting point that you bring up. Starbucks is an international brand, and one thing that is also international is anti-blackness and is racial bias. So it'd be very interesting to figure out, you know, does this happen in its locations in Europe, in airports? But for me, again, I agree with you in the sense that is whether or not this is a PR move. Look, an afternoon of racial bias training, and we don't even know exactly what is going to be entailed in that training, is not going to solve the issue. What I argued in my piece for the Washington Post was that this is an American problem. So when you have white folks, non-black people of color, that are so quick to call the police on black people in a particular space, knowing what we know about what can happen to black people after encounters with police, whether it be arrests, detentions, or injury, or even death, I think is what we really need to be talking about. So who's going to train not only, you know, the Starbucks employees, but who's going to train teachers refraining from calling the police on black kids in schools? Who's going to teach or train the mom and pop stores, real estate developers, landlords? I mean, really and honestly, I think America needs about 100 years worth of racial bias training.
In your piece, you wrote, you ask, I should say, white America, where can we be free? Where can we be safe? Where can we be black?
Yeah, and that's a throwback to the pop singer Solange. She tweeted that perhaps 2 years ago after the footage of, you know, police brutality. I mean, that's really the fundamental question. I think for some reason the Starbucks incident has really sort of shaken me up and has shaken up a lot of my friends. I think Starbucks has sort of branded itself even as a place where you can just go and sit and chill. I mean, I've gone to Starbucks and have not bought anything and waited for friends or waited for meetings and had nothing happen to me. But I think it's this issue of where we can just be black and not have the cops called on us, not be kicked out of spaces. And it just really kind of has this eerie throwback to even a sort of segregation era feeling of we just don't belong and the police can be called on us for any moment. Remember, these guys are only there for 2 minutes. 2 minutes.
Yeah, that's the stunning part.
You know? Yeah.
I had a caller to my radio program say something provocative. I asked the question, is implicit bias uniquely American? And a caller said to me, what's uniquely American is the combination of implicit bias and a gun culture, which adds another dynamic to all of this. You get the final word. Go ahead.
Yeah, I mean, we live in a culture and a history where fear of black skin is as American as pie or baseball. And I think, for us to be able to deal with this, the Starbucks incident is just another long line of incidents where, again, force can be used as a form of social control. This is a form of social control of black people in public spaces. And really, until we have this national, not only conversation, but active steps to really treat black people as first-class citizens, I'm not sure that just one day of training is really going to help anything, unfortunately.
Karen Atiyah, thank you so much for being here from The Washington Post.
Thank you so much, Michael.
Hey, by the way, we reached out repeatedly to Starbucks for a comment on my question. Why not all Starbucks worldwide? But we never heard back. I'd love to hear what they would say just in terms of explaining that decision. I'm intrigued by it. Let's see what you're saying via my social media. What do we have, Catherine? There's a difference between implicit and explicit bias, and while implicit bias is not a uniquely U.S. problem, it is a larger problem here than in other areas of the world. Now, Nick, I don't doubt that, but I don't know how you could substantiate it. And I just don't know. I don't have enough experience, but, you know, I watch enough football from overseas to know that some of these players of color have been subjected to all sorts of offensive statements and bias and discrimination. So, to me, whatever it's going on here, it's not just uniquely American. And we're reaching a worldwide audience right now. So, folks, you can comment. I remind you to go to Smirconish.com, weigh in on today's survey question. Does President Trump deserve credit for the announcement from Kim Jong-un that North Korea will stop nuclear tests and launches of intercontinental ballistic missiles? Still to come, at Bill Cosby's sexual assault retrial, model Janice Dickinson testified that Cosby